Radio Free Cybertron.
Transformers.
Rewind.
This week on Transformers Rewind, it's Five Faces of Darkness.
The Great Wars are over. The Autobots have won. The surviving Decepticons, without a leader and desperately low on energon, retreated to the burned-out planet of Char.
Once Decepticons nearly held the Quadrant through terror, now we scrap like slargs over a few energon cubes. Is this the fate of the mighty Decepticon Empire?
In desperation, they realized that their only hope for survival was Galvatron.
The memory bank must be in here. There it is. Find me the last visual appearance of Galvatron.
But the only clue to their former leader's present location pointed the way to a fiery, distant planet called Thro. Meanwhile, the triumphant Autobots sent Blur and Wheelie with the transforming cog to Autobot City on Earth. But mysterious invaders attacked and kidnapped Ultra Magnus, Cup, and Spike.
What happened to them all? They're gone.
Yeah, and I'll lay odds on who did it.
This planet is quarantined. Nobody comes, nobody goes until we find Cup, Spike, and Magnus.
And what if we don't?
Then we'll trash every Decepticon in the galaxy.
Are the kidnappers Decepticons or some other race of evil beings? The search for an answer took Rodimus Prime and Grimlock to Char, the new headquarters of the Decepticons. After Rodimus Prime and Grimlock are rescued from the Decepticons by Arcee and Springer, the Autobots realize that the Decepticons are now too weak to have kidnapped Ultra Magnus, Cup, and Spike. But if they didn't, who did? To find the answer, Rodimus Prime traveled deep within himself into the matrix of leadership and emerges with the incredible answer.
The Quintessons.
Galvatron emerges from the lava plasma of the planet Thrall to lead the Decepticons.
Come, Decepticons! We have an empire to regain!
Meanwhile, a daring raid led by Rodimus Prime and the Aerial Bots freed Ultra Magnus, Cup, and Spike an instant before the planet was detonated by the deadly Quintesson. To learn the secret of who the Quintessons really are, Rodimus short-circuited himself and went deep into the Autobot matrix of leadership, embarking on a journey into Cybertron's distant past. He discovered that the Quintessons were the creators of both the Autobots and the Decepticons.
Cybertron's in deadly danger. We're heading back there.
Now, the Quintessons are intent on reclaiming Cybertron at any cost. To do it, they begin a deadly assault against both Earth and Cybertron itself.
Decepticons! Attack!
The Decepticons will destroy the Autobots. Then we will crush the Decepticons. And soon, Cybertron will be ours!
I think we can all agree that Five Faces of Darkness is probably the greatest piece of art that human genius has ever produced. Everybody agree?
It's funny because I'm a fan of abstract art, and you're correct.
I love Five Faces of Darkness. Watching it again was a treat.
It's really the sequel to the 86 movie,
isn't it? It is.
Yeah,
it's intended to be.
Yeah, it's a complete follow-up. It's like literally, and now, the Transformers. Well, what are we going to do now, guys? Hope he's back.
Yeah. So Flint Dilley wrote both this and the movie. Mm. And it was glorious. So much better than the movie.
It has more to it, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah. It sure does. Let's see here.
It has more to it, but it's all in the last 22 minutes.
That's not true.
Yeah. It's just spread out. It maybe could have been an episode shorter, and it would have been probably a tighter overall episode.
I think that it's, I don't want to say it's tight, but I think that there's a lot to it. There's so much Transformers Cybertronian lore that's packed into this, and it's both the old, in a sense, looking back into history, it's new history, it's retconned history, but it's history, and so much new stuff. It's the first time we see the Predacons, it's the first time we see Trypticon. Scott. It's the first time we see anything that's season three that's not in the movie. There's so much to it. Skylynx, for God's sakes.
Fighting Predaking.
Yes!
And I wish, though, the rebirth had gotten, like, I wish this had been, like, four episodes, like you said, Rob, and that extra episode could have, like, this was
an extra episode could have dove more into like the nature of Headmaster RC,
or just the Nebulon, the structure, the hive, and all. Just a little more backstory. Looking at Five Faces of Darkness, it's a fine five-parter that could have been four. And like Rob said, without a big loss of anything.
Yeah, just not so much filler to fill up the time.
Yeah.
So,
it's so much out of the blue. Just so much. This is part of the Transformer universe. Looks like the Matrix, which we had never heard of until the movie. Then all of a sudden, you have all this backstory. Just like, okay, back up the exposition a little bit more, a little bit more, and dump it.
But I mean, if you think through the first two seasons, like, you know, there's little bits and pieces about what things were from Cybertron, but there was never any real world building for this as a society or, like, you know, a race that's been living for however many millions of years. Like, this was finally looking at, this is where this stuff came from. This is the origin they didn't know about, and this is the, like, backstory to everything, and this is why there is the Matrix of Leadership. Still didn't really explain Unicron, and neither did call them the primitives, but, you know.
What's kind of neat about it is, you know, the movie really kind of set the new direction, you know, from the first two seasons, but this really sets it, because it's like, the movie's basically, hey, did you kids like heavy metal? Well, here's a PG version.
Yeah.
You know, this is like, here's the next season, guys. It's now a space opera.
It really is. So what I like about this, it's exactly what you said. It sets the stage for season three. Season three is very much a space opera. And all the stuff on Earth, what we find out. So where in G1, all of the humans were either construction workers, Asian scientists, or
some overlap of the three.
Or some overlap of three. In this, all humans are either some vague Eastern European pauper, stereotypical Arabs, or futuristic spacefaring Americans.
And everyone in the year 2005 will be wearing jumpsuits with their initial.
No, not everybody. Not if you're one of the poor Eastern European paupers.
Oh, true, true, true.
Yeah.
You guys remember when we did that a few years back?
Oh, yeah. So
I still have mine.
So the thing is, this takes place in 2005, and it's sort of hard to think that's the past. So yep. Watching it...
That's the future, dude. What are you talking about?
I know. So watching it...
2010 is the past.
When they're on the... What's the name of the planet? Goo? Was it Goo?
Planet Goo.
Yeah. Yeah. So when they're on that and they're in that garbage scowl thing, they're CRTs that they're watching stuff on. But we don't... Oh, wait. 10 years ago, there were still CRTs, but it's the future. It's just kind of this awkward thing in my head.
But, no, but you have to remember, though... It's junky on technology. It's junk they found floating in space. True. This is CRTs from 1994 that are being blasted off in rockets as everybody switched over to, square flat panels.
It was a slow transition. 2010, they were still using them. It's because, like, why do I need to buy a new one?
Yeah, it's 2005. You're exactly right.
Yeah, I mean, I had a flat screen in 2005. That's because I had an iMac.
I didn't.
You know, yeah, it came with it.
So basically what this episode does, it goes in and tries to reconcile the new things that happened in the movie with this existing universe that you're supposed to be living in. So one of the big things that happened at the end of Transformers, the movie, is Galvatron got flung off into space.
Yeah!
And basically the Decepticons, when the first episode starts, well, the Autobots are in great shape. They're having basically the intergalactic Olympics.
They're having Olympics.
Yeah.
And Jazz ain't saying anything.
Yeah, things are good for the Autobots. The Decepticons
ain't saying nothing.
Bad shape.
They're all starving.
They have been kicked to the curb and flushed down the sewer.
So they agree that they need their leader, a strong leader, like the Autobots had, which is kind of a nice little jab at Rodimus. Mm-hmm. So Cyclonus decides I gotta go get Galvatron. And my God, Galvatron is crazy as hell.
He's just been bubbling in some lava for an unspecified amount of time.
He's crazy and powerful.
And sounds like Frank Welker.
I vastly prefer Frank Welker Galvatron to Leonard Nimoy Galvatron.
The thing is, like, Leonard Nimoy Galvatron works perfectly for movie Galvatron.
Mm. Absolutely, he was this
he is the overpowering menace. And in season three, Frank Welker Galvatron is great because he just sounds batshit.
Yeah, he's crazy.
He's just right. Not a plot of season three has taken him to the funny farm.
I love
Web World is the best episode of anything.
I mean, Galvatron, it's like Megatron, pretty useless bad guy. Galvatron, still useless, but we all love him. I mean, this guy is hilarious.
So, yeah, so,
and it's the start of the Cyclonus abusive relationship, unfortunately.
Man, he just beat the piss out of him for whatever reason. Didn't
yeah,
he?
And the sweeps. I would hate to have been a sweep.
You know, you got to wonder if there's a scene where they're looking like, why did we get this guy again?
Basically,
I mean, Cyclonus, you led the. Why didn't you take over?
So, I'm still trying to figure out my voice sounds like this now.
So one thing I always thought was interesting was because Galvatron, this is part of my human brain trying to reconcile Transformers logic, I guess. Galvatron was, in my mind, a new character. Yes, he was based on Megatron, but he was entirely different. But Astro Train in this, it just takes for granted that Galvatron was Megatron. I was surprised that they knew that. It seemed like, I mean, Starscream in Transformers the movie made that connection, sort of. But,
and everybody was listening when he said so.
You think? But he's like, you think so? You think that was it?
Everybody was standing there.
But
well, Cyclonus and Scourge came by to visit. Maybe they were like,
they knew.
You guys know, right?
That you know, there was that intervening time. It's like if
I might be Thundercracker or Bug. I don't know who I am. Really.
Oh, it's like it's like that thing. Rumors spread around. Oh yeah, well he was Megatron. Yeah, that makes sense. I can see that.
Plus, also,
the thing for them to understand, even if Galvatron was a new individual, technically, I don't think it's a big thing to know that, well, Galvatron was made from Megatron, or we threw Megatron out of the ship that time. Remember that, guys? That was pretty great.
Yeah. Well, we paid for that.
And they're all looking like, hey, Astro Train, why aren't you the leader? You convinced us to throw, you convinced us it was really heavy in space. Yeah. We're from space, and we fell for it. And he's like, I'm not a good planner.
So,
I kind of freaked out after y'all threw him out.
So basically, the gist of this episode is the Quintessons are the creators of the Transformers. And they consider the Transformers kind of a nuisance and a threat. So they want to get rid of them. So ultimately, they try to pit the Decepticons against the Autobots. And they just basically want to turn on the Decepticons and get rid of them all in one fell swoop.
They had the best plan for getting rid of the Transformers too. There's a switch.
Well, you know, Flint Dilly, everybody.
So, are you friends with Flint Dilly on Facebook?
I was till I think I offended him one day. Forgetting, you know, you forget you friend celebrities or celebrities.
Yeah.
Because, you know, they're not your friends. They don't even comment or anything. Occasionally you see they're like...
I've made friends with Neil Kaplan and Gary Chalk.
Yeah, those guys are cool. But, you know, I mean, most of them, it's just like, this is my publicity page. They don't really do much with it. And then one day, and like, I completely forgot because there's nothing coming from this account. And I read Autocracy and I'm like...
I don't comment on things like that.
And I just tweeted out, they're just kind of making autographs as they go along, don't they? And a little bit later, I'm like, hey, what am I friends with Flint and Dilly?
Yeah, but so...
And I look, nope.
But Flint Dilly, I think, in all seriousness, I love Five Faces of Darkness. And I really appreciate Transformers the movie for what it is. And in one hand, I love it, because I can quote it word for word, and I've watched it hundreds of times. Other hand, it kind of traumatized me. But Five Faces of Darkness goes a long way with the world building, goes a long way to make things better for me. And it really did a great job of setting up season 3.
Five Faces of Darkness would be better received overall if it wasn't so ACOM.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's...
Yeah, so...
Because, there's strong story elements in there, and there's stuff that is really important for Transformers going forward, even beyond just, like, the confines of Season 3. But, you know, the animation just kind of knocks everything down, and you're not really paying attention to what it's doing as opposed to, like, what it's not measuring up to.
Like, miscolored Transformers in the background, characters...
Off-model,
characters that shouldn't be there.
Or everything taking a moment for Grimlock to eat a gun.
Oh, Grimlock. So this was the... Grimlock and the Dinobots were stupid in seasons 1 and 2. But they had this sort of menacing sort of vibe around them. They were a threat.
They were like barbarian stupid.
Yeah.
I'm scared.
In Transformers the movie, they were stupid in a in a less threatening way. By season three, they were comic relief, and
they were just there.
They jumped straight into comic relief in this episode,
and they were never in any, they were never in robot mode.
No, Grimlock was in robot mode.
Fortunately,
yeah.
And that one.
He was in robot mode in the first part one.
And Slag was in robot mode in like part three when he was
a Decepticon, because he was a Decepticon in that scene.
I don't know. No. There was a scene where Slag in robot mode was walking with the Autobot party.
No, there's a scene where Snarl is actually with the Decepticons, waving his arms. It's not Slag. It's Snarl that I saw.
Okay. Yeah, there's another one.
ACOM.
Yeah. Yeah.
ACOM. ACOM at almost their worst.
Yeah. Plus, there was that episode where Daniel gets transported with Grimlock to the magical planet where the Quintesson was exiled. And Grimlock was in robot mode there for like a
few
frames.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. So in this episode, though, so many things introduced. It introduced the, Earth Defense Force? Or what is it?
Earth Defense Command.
And Marissa Fairborn.
Yeah.
Marissa Fairborn's one-man unit.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, she is awesome. I mean, she goes and she's...
Well, I mean, you saw the, outer orbital platform people. They just got blown away, you know, no problem. She's the only one that actually survived.
Well, she's the daughter of Flint and Lady J, who grows very fast into a middle-aged woman from 1985.
Yeah, it's...
She just has an unfortunate voice. She spent most of her teen years smoking.
Yeah.
Them Decepticons are glowing again. Crap.
Yeah, okay. But let's see here. What else? So many characters get debut in this. We mentioned Trypticon. We get a battle, an awesome battle that actually shows some scale that we lack in some later episodes between Trypticon and Metroplex. Mm-hmm. That's just super enjoyable to watch. Yeah.
And also, we see the Predacons for the first time, and they act like they're setting up a big rivalry between Skylynx and the Predacons. It doesn't really go anywhere outside of...
Actually, and speaking of that, it features the so-called rivalry between Galvatron and Ultramagnus, because they have that face-off, and Galvatron flees, because they're the same price point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. but then I'm glad they switched it to Cyclonus and Ultramagnus, because they're really both professional soldiers on opposites, and that makes a lot. I guess that's one of the saving graces of the Killing Jar, which is not one of my favorite episodes, but the interplay
should be.
Yeah,
yeah, that's a great episode.
It reminds you there's competent guys in leadership.
Yeah,
exactly. And, but you know, I liked it's Blaster says, they're still on Io's Jupiter's moon. Good old Skylynx better get there soon. And the Quintesson says, thank you for telling us about Skylynx. We'll tell the Predacons so we can kill him. It's like, the hell?
Here comes death.
There's Razor Claw right now. Just jumped up right on your lap. Yes.
All right, we're going to get an accidental reenactment of that fight any minute now. Yeah.
But all in all, I mean, I do really like Five Phases of Darkness. I'm not even joking. It's one of my favorite episodes. It's not my favorite episode. But it does so much to right the wrongs of Transformers the movie that I give it a lot of credit.
Some weird stuff in there, too, though. Like, the Constructicons turn an actual human city into Trypticon overnight while everybody's asleep.
Yeah, that's...
Okay. Transformers logic.
Yeah.
One thing to add, if you guys check out the Tommy Kennedy version... It's online.
Oh, yeah, you watched the Tommy Kennedy version of this.
Yeah, because I have the regular version, but I just didn't feel like digging out the DVD. Optimus is absolutely hysterical. Like, the second episode, like, Tommy's like, well, I've got to go. I'll come back tomorrow. I'll tell you some more. Okay, I'll transform your world. Yeah, and he flies away. Well, it comes back, and Tommy's like, you got to tell me more. He's like, I don't know. Like, Optimus generally does not want to tell him what's happening. he's like, yeah. And then the beginning, you know, the first episode, Optimus's narration kind of leads you to believe it's been quite a while since the movie. Like, it might, there's no telling how long. He's like, for a while, we were okay. I mean, it was just like, it's kind of abruptly, it's not horrible or offensive, but it's almost like the guy writing is providing meta commentary on what's going on. Because, like, you don't really know how long it's been since the movie and Five Faces of Darkness. You just got the feeling, a few months maybe. How long could Galvatron be soaking in that lava, you know? But this, it's almost like, man, this is, it looks like forever. They're at the Olympics now, and the world was just almost destroyed. Yeah.
It was established, though, that it was in 2005, just like the movie, right. So...
It's like, they were, just like anything else, Transformers, it's like, well, a giant monster almost ate our planet and tore everything up.
Hey, Olympics.
Yeah.
You guys want to do something else?
If this were the 1990s and I was still typing up my thoughts on Usenet, I would try to squeeze in some sort of time dilation sort of commentary in here to explain how that works. But thank God I'm an adult and I'm not going to do that.
One thing that Five Faces of Darkness in Season 3, with Rodimus having all these doubts and the perpetual... But a lot of people don't give Rodimus enough credit, and I think he was doing it. But it's like Peter Davison following Tom Baker as the Doctor. You know, it's, some shoes are really hard to fill, and no matter who you cast, you're going to have issues. I'm thinking, do you think Galvatron knocking the Matrix out of his hand during the movie, maybe he didn't have a full transformation into Rodimus Prime?
No.
I'm actually one of the people that will tell you, look, until Power Master Prime, Optimus was kind of a crappy leader, and Rodimus just really gets a bum rap because it's like, okay, hey, he's actually an effective leader.
And one thing we failed to mention though is the Decepticon Matrix, which I wish existed.
I was gonna bring that up when about the whole, and they're using the greatest non-existent MacGuffin being the Decepticon Matrix.
I have the Decepticon Matrix of Conquest.
That doesn't exist for till like 3H, man.
No, like the thing with
really
Rodimus,
kind of pointless.
He would have been just as good of a leader as Optimus Prime in the same situation we saw Optimus Prime be leader in, which was, you know, there's kind of a war going on, but it's mostly just dude hanging out with his buddies having fights with the Decepticons every once in a while. Now I think Optimus Prime would have had just as much problem being a bureaucratic leader as Rodimus Prime did. Yeah.